In the first episode of the Harvest Mining Show, we had the owner of delving into an extraordinary story of one Dr. Daniel Masava, who had a powerful source of motivation to embrace diversity, disregard one's occupational background. In this episode, we shall talk about the way Dr. Daniel Masava shifted from being a medical practitioner into a devoted farmer. Think about how one can shift from being a medical practitioner into a successful farmer. And we shall also talk about the management skills that Dr. Daniel Masava has used on his farm to become a successful farmer. Without any further delay, let us go into our show.
Jericho Sanchez once expressed the sentiment, the gratification derived from knowing that one has crafted a product that will be enjoyed by others is unmatched. In the case of Dr. Daniel Masava, this quote resonates deeply with his core being. Engaging in conversation with him evokes an unmistakable atmosphere that he has already left an indelible impact on the population through the provision of farm-to-table products. Welcome to episode 2, where we delve into the captivating journey of Dr. Daniel Masava, a seasoned practitioner in the medical field for half a decade, now passionately articulating his involvement in the realm of poultry farming. Dr. Masava is absorbed in the cultivation of a parent poultry farm, which presently indicates a staggering accumulation of 60,000 birds surrounding both broilers and layers. In his discourse, he places immense emphasis on the power of knowledge, highlighting his personal reliance on the internet as a transformative tool. He specifically acknowledges the instrumental role played by YouTube in propelling his farm forward, underscoring its priceless contribution to his progress.
Usually I share all the information that I can. I try to, you know, not hide. If I'm facing problems, I share those problems with the farmers because they need to understand the reality of what happens on the farm. There's a time I had a breakout of fall typhoid. I lost 1,000 birds on the farm. At that time, I think I had 1,500 birds, and 1,000 of the birds died because of fall typhoid. So when I have such challenges, I always make sure that I share them with people outside there so that they understand the challenges that someone goes through, because what happens to me is what can happen to you. And me growing and growing quickly like this doesn't mean that I haven't gone through challenges.
Embarking upon the establishment of a farm often presents considerable challenges, requiring great effort to initiate operations. However, it is prudent to commence this endeavor, as evidenced by the enlightening conversation with Dr. Daniel Masava, who graciously imparts his wisdom on succeeding over obstacles and defying the odds in the successful establishment of the Farm Up Farm.
So when I started, I didn't start with a big farm. Like I've told you, I started with a small section of land from my dad. Probably a quarter an acre. After that, I managed to get money in Bali. Now, land in Bali is actually quite expensive, realistically speaking, because like it's a high, densely populated area, and the land is very fragmented. So even getting a single acre owned by one person is very hard. But I was lucky enough to get 3 acres, not very far away from where my farm was. And over there, I expanded the farm. And it was from there, together with my partner, who I decided to partner with, when we came together and saved our money, that we managed to expand to the 400 acres. Now, realistically speaking, it's a lot of money, yeah? And I won't share the figures because it will be crazy for a lot of farmers. And the other thing that I usually share with farmers is that excelling in farming has nothing to do with the size of property that you have. It has nothing to do with it. A lot of people will look at 400 acres. For example, if you look at this 400 acres, a lot of it is empty. I believe when we were coming in, you saw it. A lot of it is empty. There is no chickens. There is no, you know. We just have a few goats. They don't need 400 acres to feed. We just have a few chickens. They don't need 400 acres to feed. So all that land doesn't need to be used by a farm. So for a farm, On my channel, I always share with people how to maximize using small spaces. On this current farm, we have a chicken house over there, which is a two-story chicken house. Very, very innovative. That chicken house, we feed the chickens from the top without entering. Yeah, you don't need to enter to give the chickens buds, but it's not mechanized. We don't use any electricity over there. We don't use any motors. We're not using anything imported. It was simply using knowledge that we produced from here. We came up with a feeding system that uses pipes where no one needs to enter that chicken house to give the chickens food, to give them water, and the eggs, the chicken lays the egg rolls to the outside. All those things were made from right here. Now, for you to have such a mechanism, you would need a lot of money if you're going to be importing it using machinery. You would need a lot of money. But we never needed a lot of money. You know, we don't need a lot of money because you can do it using available materials. You understand? So with farming, you don't need to have too much money. That's what I always share with people. What you need to do is start with what you have. Do what you do well. The biggest problem is that people compromise. Yeah? You don't give the chickens the best feed that they need. Instead of giving them very good feed, you give them, you know, you just mix up the feed. If the chickens, for example, need 100 kilos of feed every day, you give them 80, you're not going to get the best results. Give them everything you need, they're going to give you what you need. Carry out the correct farming practices, you know, proper biosecurity. Make sure that, for example, we are not inside the chicken house because the procedure to go inside the chicken house is very complicated, and I just won't let everyone go inside the chicken house. So I can't let, for example, a team enter the chicken house. It would be very, very difficult for me, considering how much money I've put in inside the birds. It just doesn't make sense. So how much you start with is not what matters. What matters is to do things properly, and then you'll grow very systematically and very rapidly at that if you do things properly.
Jeopardizing the fortification of biosecurity measures within your agricultural domain presents an immense threat. The endeavor to breach the fortified confines of the poultry house at Farm Up Farm entails a formidable undertaking, given the latent hazards that invaders might innocently bring out, thereby engendering infection and the consequential reduction of your feathered population.
So the process to go inside the chicken house is not an easy one, because human beings, diseases brought to chickens are almost always brought by human beings. It's very unlikely that a disease is going to come from heaven and enter the chicken house. The biggest percentage is brought by human beings, by contact, some form of contact. So we need to minimize the number of times that a person enters the chicken house, whether it's to give them feed, whether it's to give them water. That's why I've told you that we've even come up with an innovative chicken house where no one needs to enter the chicken house to give them feed. So for someone, for all the workers who work in the chicken houses, number one, before they enter the chicken house, they need to have a bath. They need to take a bath with soap and water. And after taking your bath, you change into your overalls with your gumboots, and then you step in a foot bath, and then you get in. And then when you get in, if you get out, for you to get in, you have to go through the same process. Yeah? So if you get out of the chicken house 10 times a day, you're going to bathe 10 times a day. Now, I always tell people that, and a lot of people feel like it's too much. But if you consider how much money you're putting into the farm, it's nothing. No one has ever died from overbathing. Bathing doesn't kill, yeah? So you can bathe 10 times a day, go in. There's nothing wrong with it. But if you don't, you compromise with it. For example, these birds are very expensive birds. These are breeder birds. They are imported from, you know, from Europe, yeah? And compared to a commercial chicken, you know, a commercial layer. A commercial layer, for example, one commercial layer costs about €1. You can put it in terms of euro. One commercial layer costs about €1. For the breeders, you're going to pay about €6, six times as much for one chick. Yeah? You convert that to Ugandan shillings, that's a lot of money. That's almost 30,000 shillings for a single chicken. For a day-old chick, you can imagine. So if you're keeping 10,000 of them, 5,000 of them, how much money is it? So it doesn't make sense for you to compromise with entering the chicken house simply because you want to do something quickly, yeah? The best thing to do is to follow all the correct steps. Yes, the people who work inside here go through the same system. We have baths around the farm. We have water, it's available in plenty. We've dug wells, boreholes, they call them boreholes. We've dug boreholes, over 3 boreholes on the farm. And we have water. Each of the chicken houses has a bathroom area where people have to take their baths. They leave their uniforms over there, they change their uniforms, and they go and work inside there. We try to make sure that even the workers, the places they stay in, they don't interact as much. So the people who, for example, work in the layers section have their accommodation that side. The people who work in the broiler section have their accommodation towards that side to try to minimize the interaction, because all the interactions within workers lead to an increased risk of spread of disease. We try to make sure that the farmers don't go off the farm. So here, all the accommodation, the farmers stay on the farm. Because every time someone goes off the farm, when they come back, that's a risk for a disease. Because you don't know where they have been. Yeah? So you try to make sure that they stay on the farm. And then, you know, your days of leave accumulate. You take your days of leave. You go home, spend your time at home. And then when you come back, you're again going to spend time on the farm. And that minimizes the risk of bringing disease onto the farm.
Today, Dr. Masaba possesses a grand total of 60,000 flock within the confines of his agricultural domain. During our enlightening interaction, he disclosed that his initial flock numbered a modest 3,000, yet in the mere span of three short years, he astutely scored a remarkable increase, resulting in the current prolific population. Fascinated by his supreme feat, we embarked on a quest to unravel the methods behind his resounding success.
So the farm is a breeder farm, it's mainly a breeder farm. But before, in the past, we've had commercial layers. We had 20,000 commercial layers that we kept on the farm simply to test them out. It was for experimental purposes. Because when we hatched the very first chicks that we hatched as a farm, we didn't want to give them to the farmers. And they come back and tell us, "Hey, Nkoko Zamwe, your birds do this, they're not good at laying, they're not." So we kept them on the farm, we give them the ideal things that we're supposed to give them and see how they perform. Then the next time we go to a farmer, the farmer won't tell us that your birds are like this when we know we have the same birds on the farm. If the birds don't perform well, then we know what we are dealing with on the farm. But we kept that batch on the farm and that we got rid of. So currently we only keep breeder birds, and currently the farm has a capacity for 10,000 layer parent stock for breeders and 40,000 broiler parent stock. So that's 50,000 in total, but we are also expanding. We're also expanding, and the goal is to do 200,000 broiler breeders and 30,000 layer breeders.
Achieving success in the empire of poultry farming is devoid of complexities and necessitates farmers to diligently adhere to fundamental protocols as outlined by Dr. Masaba.
So for a farmer who is watching and learning today, succeeding in poultry farming is nothing complicated. In poultry farming, they're what they call protocols. Me, I came from a doctor background, and I understand what they are called protocols. And even in everything in life, they're usually protocols. In the military, they are protocols. You follow this and follow this one step after the other. When it comes to poultry farming, when you bring the chickens in, you need to ensure absolute hygiene. That one it's not a compromise. Absolute hygiene. I always try to make sure all my farms are fenced. If you can look around, there are fences all over this farm, because we want to make sure that the people who work in other sections don't cross over to this section. That increases the risk of disease on the farm. The two biggest things that cause losses on farms are, number one, diseases, and number two, poor nutrition. Where do diseases come from? Diseases are brought in by human beings. You understand? When someone comes from the outside, someone comes, kanzijenda weku nkoko zo. Let me come and take a look at your chickens. And then you're like, come and see my chickens are nice. So all your relatives, they come, they enter the chicken house. All your neighbors, they come, they enter the chicken house. Everyone enters the chicken house. That is very wrong. For me, people don't come to check on my chickens. I don't allow people. Actually, a lot of people ask to come to this breeder farm. I think I've only had about two or three visitors come to this farm, and they come because they must come. Yeah. So the only people who are allowed to come to my farms are people who must come. So you're a vet, or you're someone who has come, for example, for regulations, maybe the ministry and their particular regulations that they must come to the farm, then I will let them come. But you don't just come to see my farm because I want to visit. Because for me, it's a risk. I probably put in, 500 million, let's say, on the farm. You're coming simply to see. You're going to kill my 500 million. It doesn't make sense. So for me, it's a risk that I never take. Yeah. The other thing, make sure that there's clean water everywhere. People need to make sure they bathe. Bathing, like I said, has never killed anyone. If people are entering the chicken house, give them overalls. You know, you can give them overalls, but some people don't have money to buy overalls. Just have clothes that are dedicated, that these clothes are for working inside the chicken house. When you get out, you leave them somewhere else. You do your own things. When you're coming back, only those clothes must be used to enter the chicken house. The other thing, make sure that the birds are fed with the correct feed. Don't ever compromise with the feed. Never ever compromise with the feed. You see, what happens with chickens is that, for example, commercial layers, they can lay up to 95%. What that means is that for every 100 chickens, you can get 95 eggs. That's 95% every day. Now, a lot of people, what they do is that they will compromise and he will say, I don't have enough money. Let me give them less feed. When you give them less feed, if you're giving them less feed, you might save, let's say, 20,000 every day. When you save 20,000 every day on their feed, you're going to decrease their percentage from 95 to 80%. When you decrease that percentage, that 15% difference means that you're losing 50,000 in terms of eggs every day. You understand? So every time you compromise on feed, you're making a bigger loss.
In order to ensure the prosperity of your poultry farm, it is imperative to incorporate hygiene as a fundamental prerequisite. Dr. Masaba provides invaluable guidance on effectively implementing and maintaining hygienic practices within your farm.
The farm starts right from the entrance. Yeah. So when someone is coming onto the farm, if they're coming with a vehicle, you need to make sure that that vehicle is sprayed. It goes through a tire dip. If the tire dip is not available, sometimes, you know, people don't have money for tire dips. You can spray the tires of the vehicle to make sure that, you know, the car goes in clean. A car should only come onto the farm if it must come onto the farm. If the car must not come onto the farm, don't bring it in, yeah? Let it park somewhere, yeah? Then when the vehicles come into the farm, they should park somewhere. They shouldn't be moving all around the farm. The people who access the chicken houses, you need to make sure that these are the correct people. These people need to make sure that they bathe. These people wash their hands before they enter these houses. You need to make sure that you spread disinfectant around these chicken houses. You need to make sure that there is a foot dip with disinfectant every time before you enter a chicken house. You need to make sure that water that's provided to the chickens is clean water. It shouldn't be water that's just flowing in a river. It needs to be water that a human being should also drink, because if that water can cause a human being diseases, that means it can cause chickens diseases. So you need to make sure that the water is clean. You need to make sure that the food itself is clean. You need to make sure that all the equipment that is used while handling the poultry is clean equipment, yeah? So whether it's the drinkers, you need to make sure that the drinkers are cleaned, either cleaned every day or the automatic drinkers, yeah? So if they're automatic drinkers, you might probably not need to clean them every day because that won't be entering. But if it's the kind of drinkers that get dirty every day, you need to make sure that they are cleaned each and every day. You need to make sure that the surrounding around the chicken house is clean, yeah? You don't want to find very huge bushes. You see, you see when we're coming on the farm, since the farm is huge, we have bushes in some areas. But when you come closer to the chicken houses, you try to minimize the bushes, yeah? Because all those bushes are what are going to cause diseases. You see this space between the chicken house and the house? There's no grass over here. And the reason we've left this space over here is so that, you know, we don't have grass reaching the chicken house. We have a space that we are very sure it is actually clean and it's not going to bring us any issues on the chicken house. So those are the issues that need to be considered in terms of hygiene.
However, does he effectively oversee the comprehensive security measures of a poultry farm housing in excess of 60,000 chickens, ensuring the absence of any vulnerabilities or weaknesses?
So with the farm, you need multiple layers of security. One layer of security won't work. The best or the quickest one and the easiest one is to put fences. That's the quickest deterrent. It not only will protect you from other people coming inside, it will also protect you from, you know, wild animals, from other people's chickens, you know, local chickens, all those kinds of chickens that can bring in diseases. So fences. Number two, gates. I always talk about gates a lot because gates need to be kept closed on farms. A lot of people enter gates and they leave them open. What's the purpose of the gate now if you leave it open? I always tell people who work on the farm, close the gates behind you. Close the gates behind you. Number three, security. Real security people on the farm. As you can see on the farm, we have security people on the farm. If you have a very huge investment, it doesn't make sense for you to not put in some extra money. You know, paying security is not so much. For you to put in some extra money to try and safeguard your investment. You understand? You put some extra money. Usually security people are paid 150, 200 every month. Put it in to try and safeguard your, you know, 500 million, 200 million. Put it in. It will save you a lot. So that's the other layer that we put. Number four, we've done cameras. The firm has cameras all around it. Yeah, that can be monitored. You know, I can just use my phone, it doesn't matter where I am, to try and check. Before, in the past, we had an issue of theft where people would steal each other's property, you know. Someone steals someone's phone, someone steals someone. And after two or three encounters, when the people actually noticed that all the people actually, we actually caught them using cameras. And when we catch them with cameras, we take them to police. The police deals with you. After that, the people actually notice that we are being watched. So they stopped. So the firm is now very safe. You leave your phone here and you'll find it after an entire day. Yet we have a lot of people working in the firm. So that's another thing that has helped. Number four, dogs. Dogs. So we have dogs. We have over 9 dogs on the farm. So, you know, some of them are properly trained, really, really good guard dogs. Because some of the places you won't be able to reach. The farm is a very big farm. So the dogs will move around on the farm and they will work on the security on the farm. But number five, it's also trying to hire people who can be trusted and explaining protocols on the farm. Yeah? You put protocols in line on the farm. If the eggs are laid, they have to be collected at this time. The eggs only go to this place. So if I find an egg in another place, there's no other explanation. That egg was trying to be stolen.
In the realm of agriculture, maintaining meticulous records holds utmost significance for your farming enterprise. However, the art of effectively managing these records presents itself as the complementary side of this endeavor. Dr. Masaba clarifies the proper methodology whereby you can proficiently administer these records, ensuring their accuracy and completeness with unwavering precision.
So the advantage with having a firm is that you can put management and multi-tier management. Yeah, that's how farms should be run. For example, we have layers over here, we have broilers somewhere, we might have a brooder somewhere and chickens are inside the brooder. We have a feed mill somewhere, someone is, you know, producing the feed. Each of the units has a leader. Each of the units has a leader, and the responsibility of everyone at the top of that unit, one of their responsibilities is to make sure that there are records being reported every day. So everyone will have a hard copy book, a physical book, where they report, whether it is the layers, the person in charge of the layer breeders, this is how much feed we gave every day, this is how much medicine we gave, if there is medicine being given, this vaccine was given today, this number of eggs was collected. Every day, every unit has a book where the person at the top of each of those units has to collect those records, and every day all those records are supplied to the general farm manager.
In our quest for knowledge, we endeavor to determine the number of workers attending to a vast area spanning 400 acres alongside a population comprising 60,000 chickens.
So currently the farm has quite a number of workers. I think they're about 80 or so, over 80 workers. And the thing with having many farm workers is that you need to put in charge a management structure. That's what I've been talking about, where it's not just one person at the top who is leading everyone. Each of these units has a leader who reports to someone else. It makes it so easy to manage a farm. So this is a breeder farm, and the main goal is to produce the old chicks. So what you would probably call value addition in this case would be us getting the eggs, our own eggs. We take them to our hatchery, we hatch these chicks, yeah, and we shall package them and deliver them to clients, yeah?
Dr. Daniel Masaba's departure from the medical profession has proven to be a prosperous and triumphant endeavor as farming takes center stage in the battle against poverty and unemployment. This alternative path has yielded favorable outcomes. Without further delay, let us now delve into the latest development within the agricultural industry.
Now, away from the amazing story of Dr. Daniel Masaba on how he moved away from medical practice into poultry farming, let's take a look at what happened with our farmers who just last week visited the Netherlands to see how best farmers can make the most out of their farms. We, you know, our 2019 farmers actually did travel, and with them were a group of journalists from the Vision Group. And one of them was our broadcast journalist, Suleiman Mutebi, who went with the group
We want you, Suleiman, to tell us what the experience was like visiting the farms in the Netherlands with our farmers. How was it like?
Thank you so much. Our journey was interesting. We reached at 8 a.m. on Sunday. And then first thing, we went to the hotel, Amsterdam Hotel. We kept our bags. We didn't book in, we just kept them in store. The hotels are so busy, they have a lot of people. Then we went to boat cruise. We had breakfast and lunch on boat cruise around Amsterdam. Then our farmers were surprised to see people sleeping in boats. People have houses in boats. Now, even me myself, since this is where we grab land, I told them, but now can't I get a plot there?
Right.
They told me, no, you have to pay
rent.
You buy, you first buy, then you pay service fee for every month for the what? For your boat to be there. But you can see a boat that has stayed there for 6 days. And it was such an interesting trip. Then the following day, we moved from the water at around 5. At 5, it is still day there.
5 p.m.?
Yes,
5 p.m.
5 p.m.
Yes.
It gets dark at around midnight.
Wow.
That's when it gets dark. So you go to sleep when it is still day. You have to create an environment.
Where you have to sleep.
Yes.
Interesting.
And then
the
following day, we went to a farm. It is called Sosi Farm. It's they're doing cattle keeping. The man owns 60 cows. He's milking 20 cows and he's milking 200 liters per day. 200 liters
out of
per
20
day.
Cows.
Yes.
How is that possible?
He owns 42 acres of land. Then I asked him that why is it that you only have 60 cows? He told me that they are limited by the government. Because they are farmers and they don't want to waste their items that they get from the cows and are polluting the environment. So you are limited.
The environment sensitive.
Yes.
Okay.
They are limited. He told me that he can keep 146 cows because each cow needs 1 acre. But because of the laws, he can only keep that. He has a wife and two children. They are the only people on the farm.
Are they the workers or he has a workforce?
They are the workers. Actually, what I saw in Netherlands, you cannot go to a farm looking for a job.
Oh.
Yes. Because the man is milking using a robot.
Oh.
The man,
mechanized, I can't say mechanized because these are more advanced gadgets because it's talking about robots. Artificial intelligence.
They're milking using a robot.
Yeah.
And I squatted down to see how exactly the robot works.
I would have done the same.
It is more than a person.
Right.
Because it washes the under. It smears Vaseline, then it puts on the milking gadgets, then it starts milking. When it is milking, the milk goes to the meter, to the measurement scales, then it goes to a container, no handling on the milk.
Wow.
Up to the vehicle, you don't touch anything.
Wow.
Then from the milking, the man asked us a question, that how many liters of water do you give to your cows in your country? One of the farmers whispered at me, sometimes we give it a basin, sometimes it goes without water. Then he told us that his cow, each one takes 140 liters per day.
Wow, what a huge contrast.
And it takes in 100, average 100 kilograms of feeds. And now,
One cow. Wow.
He has 60. And everyone was wondering, where do you get the feeds?
The money.
And they are farmers.
Right.
Yes, they are farmers. They are not regionals. They are farmers. So that showed me that actually, For us, we don't do anything right.
Right.
Yes. We are just...
We have a long way to go.
Yes. I can judge like that.
What an amazing story, Suleiman Mutebi. I was listening to you and I just got this dream that I want to be a farmer someday and be like those Dutch farmers, because I believe what they're doing in the Netherlands is quite amazing. We hope we can have Suleiman again back sometime to tell us more of this story. For now, we go back to Rosemary to wrap up the show for us. I've been Jackie Chan. Until next time, goodbye.
This positive appeal makes everyone think of how one can shift from being a medical practitioner to a devoted farmer. If a doctor can shift from being a medical doctor into a successful farmer, this means that farming has had a meaningful name in this country. This marks the end of our show that runs on Urban TV every Tuesday with me, Rosemary Tukundane. Till next time, bye-bye.